I think maintenance in the district, we have not been very proactive in looking at long-term on that, and I think that we should be...
You're talking about of buildings, you mean?
Of the buildings, yeah. That...
The kitchens.
And the kitchens, yeah, all of the kitchens, because all of our equipment in the kitchens are original, and they're all reaching their life expectancy.
We just lost... I haven't had a chance to tell you, but we did just lose the boiler in the kitchen that feeds the steamer and the kettle.
Okay, we just lost the boiler in the kitchen that feeds the steamer and the steam kettle. So those are things that I think town needs to be mindful of.
Okay, and how do you, I guess, how do you see that going into budgets? Like, is there a line item from which you're drawing money out to do these types of projects already, or...
Yes, but it's underfunded. So you're going to see us coming, the facilities director and myself are now planning, setting up time where we're planning to draw up our policies, the how we want the schools cleaned. And then along with that, what supplies we're going to need. Because we are severely underfunded for paper, and do we want to stop using paper towels because of the cost of paper, and do the one-time funding, which will take a capital outlay, to do hand dryers, and then we'd save money afterwards, but we'd have to do it, you know, have a capital outlay. But then we would be saving money by not having hand towels in the schools. Would we wax more often? Would we wax less? So we're trying to really narrow it down what we want to see done, especially changing the filters. And we don't have, I think what a lot of the school committees forget is we don't have a maintenance staff, we have a custodial staff. So there's no one to do the maintenance work. And so that we're looking long range. Do we want to start creating a maintenance people for all five schools that can go and do that? And that's something we've talked about in their town administrator meetings, because they could take care of these buildings as well, the town buildings, and we all share the cost of those maintenance people.
You're talking something more than just washing and waxing floors.
Correct.
More than just doing some occasional painting, or would you include painting and...
The custodians have been doing that. I'm talking about large things that we've had to contract out for all our HVAC, plumbing, electrical, carpentry. When we've had the four town administrator meetings, we've talked about lack of resources in the towns for HR, technology, and maintenance. And that, you know, and this is the same through all four towns, that nobody has a designated HR person. We don't either. We have, you know, Patty, who does a large piece of it, but everybody else picks up pieces. Same thing happens here in Deerfield as it does in Conway and Sunderland and Whately. I don't know how you manage your technology piece. We at least have a technology staff who can, you know, eventually get to everybody. I don't know how you all do it in the towns. And I don't know how you do the maintenance. I'm assuming you contract out for people and have a custodial service that comes in and cleans.
But our maintenance of buildings and grounds is handled by the highway superintendent, whatever title the person actually has, but it's that position.
But if you have HVAC or plumbing or heating, you probably have to go outside.
We contract out.
Okay.
But I also remember, and probably you do too, the days when schools did their own, had their own bus drivers, probably part of the janitorial staff or the maintenance staff. And the decision was, that was years ago, and the decision was, let's contract out for this and we'll take care of the buildings.
A bus driver?
Driver.
Drivers.
Oh, what is a bus driver?
Custodians did that job in a lot of places. And the decision was made that we don't want to do that. It was probably less expensive to contract out.
Probably, and so the state mandates and regulations are so extraordinary now that
for bus drivers,
it's just, you know, you can't just have somebody do that.
Every bus company is begging for drivers because of the rigorous course requirements they have to go through to get the license.
But I you know, we don't have a plumber and we don't have a carpenter. or an electrician. And I, even though I'm sure that there were times when it would be nice to have someone, you could say, hey, go take care of this electrical problem. We just don't contract out enough, and I don't think even the five towns getting together could necessarily justify a maintenance staff that would include a carpenter and a HVAC person. And
I think the five schools could.
Well,
and we're just saying we could add the towns on.
Perhaps not, but I do think there is merit in further discussion of HR and technology services.
HR, I agree with you, and I think that's something that we need to look at.
So those are the things that I would hope finance committees would be looking at long-term. They'd be looking at capital building projects, and they'd be looking at shared services, at least in HR to start.
Marty, I would only agree, of course, these folks will know, I'll get on my maintenance talk, but I can't agree more with you with a hard look at maintenance and maybe a shared type of maintenance, but it really, as I continually keep saying, there's preventative maintenance, there's maintenance, and then there's capital. Those are three extremely distinct, different things. They all need to be funded. If they are done, and if they are done appropriately, they substantially reduce the cost of capital. And I think part of it is like, as Skip was pointing out, well, maybe all of us can't afford a HVACA or electrician or something, but when you do the preventative maintenance, when you're looking at taking care of little things on a regular basis, and it's a checklist mentality because it's computer entered.
Mm-hmm.
And, ooh, this looks like something's breaking, something's going wrong. Call somebody in, do some maintenance on it before it all goes to the pot. But at some point in time, because of this, you might be calling in the electrician or somebody, but you're defining it long before it really gets bad, and you're preventing a lot of things from ever getting to that point. So I personally think it's a mindset that all towns need to do, and if it can be shared with the schools, I'm fully for it too, where you start to really fill these positions and you fund it. And I'm sorry to take up the time, but I have said before, in our own company we did this. It's a very formal computer program. And there were people, and that's every day. The computer spit out exactly who's going to check on what and why, and they enter it back in.
That's what we're trying to do.
Done. And it, all you can see is it really works. But the problem is everybody kind of lumps it off and says, oh, maintenance is an electrician. Well, it isn't. It's not the part I'm thinking of. The electrician is when something really needs to be changed or upgraded or something. But
you might not have to do that on a full-time basis either. What you may be able to do is if you tie in and contract it out, but you do like a basic contract, so there's a preventive element. So whether it be annual or biannual, they come in and they simply review whatever it may be, the electrical, the air, you know, the HVAC, whatever system it is. So twice a year, once a year or twice a year, they go through the whole thing, make sure everything's running, and then they're on call should something happen, and it's a pay-as-you-go system.
Yeah, I would never argue that,
Jeff.
That
may be cheaper than trying to put a person on full-time.
But the key thing is to have a formal program, however the details work out. Yep. That makes me think, like, with our injection
that's
molding.
That's where we're starting. And then where we're starting is coming up with the daily, weekly, monthly, quarterly tasks.
Because you don't know until you do that.
Maintenance. Yeah. And then we're going to start pulling our costs together. Right. And what we pay the plumber and the HVAC will gag you.
Right. Exactly.
I have to leave by 6:30 for our next meeting. So I don't know if you want to jump to Frontier or if you had any other quick questions on the elementary budget.
I mean, I'd just like to make a last comment on the elementary school budget. You know, I think thank you for the work you guys did to bring this budget to where it is. The couple of things I still notice that are concerning to me are trends of seeing increases in a couple of line items that had been paid out of some other part of the budget the year before. And I'm thinking of instructional equipment and building security systems as two examples that I think are not new expenses, but are new to the line item. Mm-hmm. And that's fine, because I do like to get things in the right place. But then there's no decreases ever in the thing they used to come out of.
And we overspend those lines.
And I understand, but that's a very dangerous trend that I've seen, not just in this budget and not just in school budgets, but in a number of budgets, of spending and then carving it out as a new line item, and then the budget's just gotten higher. So
I would hope, Dylan, that next year, because the budget is in the format that it needs to be in now,
yeah,
and that real line items are created,
yep,
that you will have an apples-to-apples comparison for next year.
That would be great. Mm-hmm. And I share your focus on maintenance and capital. I think those long-term investments are important. And I think that, you know, over the coming years, we're going to have to make a lot of choices between things we'd all like. And, you know, even this budget here is certainly, you know, at the upper end of a range that I think we can hopefully make work this year. But we do appreciate you getting it to where you got it to.
Okay, thank you.
All right, shall we talk about Frontier?
Please, yeah.
Okay.
So you should be seeing a 3.69% increase,
yes,
with an assessment of 2.30.
You're the chair of the
okay
project.
Yeah, and I have to sign up.
So you're the chair?
I'm the chair.
He's congratulations.
Congratulations, I get to sign in too.
See. So that's...
So what is
and
the 3.69, that's the general increase in the budget, the entire budget?
Correct.
What's Deerfield's increase?
What's what?
Your assessment, 2.30.
No, the total assessment is up 2.30.
Right.
To the
is that
towns.
What you were asking?
You want Deerfield's assessment?
Okay, so the 3.69, that's the budget. The assessment increase is 2.3%?
Yes. To all four towns.
Okay. And then Deerfield's...
Oh, I see what you're saying. Deerfield's...
Assessment.
Percent.
You don't have the details there on page?
What do you have?
I just printed out the two change pages just randomly to bring them over because I thought we'd have
okay
the full, but we do not.
Okay.
4.95% is Deerfield's share.
4.95.
Increase. So last year you paid a combined assessment of $3,362,166. This year you'll pay $3,528,555. And that's largely due to your increase in your minimum contribution.
Yeah, it seemed like there was a decrease in minimum contribution, or at least a foundation budget decrease on the grammar school, but that didn't really
very different
come through to any sort of decrease in that budget. So I don't think that's a great reason.
But I don't decide that, the state does.
No, I know, but it, you know, if it's a reason why this one went up, then ostensibly it'd be a reason why the other one went down, but the other one didn't go down. So
yeah. We're talking the minimum contribution.
The foundation budget broken out by school.
Not your foundation budget, your local minimum contribution.
Okay, but that's based upon those numbers.
It's based upon your community wealth and your community property.
Yes, which goes towards foundation budget that's given for each school and broken out between the elementary school and the high school.
And Franklin County Tech.
And Franklin County Tech. And so if I remember the page, there's an overall increase to the minimum contribution to Frontier, but a decrease to that of the elementary school because of the way numbers of enrolled students are. I'm not sure exactly what.
Oh, you're talking about the five-year rolling average of, is that what you're talking about?
I'm just saying that from last year to this year, that your minimum contribution for Frontier went up $125,517.
Okay.
If you want to. She's okay.
And your total increase is $166,389. So when we do the formula, first you take off your minimum contributions, and they're all up this year. They're up for two towns and down for two towns. So that gets balanced.
So you correct me where I make a mistake. So if we take the minimum contributions for each town and you add those up, then subtract that from the total budget, and then that total budget is broken down based on the five-year average.
You got it. So
those two pieces then are added together.
Right. The minimum contribution for Frontier for all four towns increased to $126,096. So seeing that yours is $125,517, Sunderland, Waitley saw decreases, and Conway saw a small increase, but you saw the largest increase. So when we look at the formula, we take the operating budget, we reduce it by the Chapter 70 aid, the school committee applied $100,000 of free cash, and we're left with $7,222,841. We take the four minimum contributions that total $4,911,113, and the amount assessed is $2,311,728. You're at 48.23% of that. So that gives you 1,114,946 added to the 2.37380, bringing your assessment to 3488. Now, if we went based on the original agreement, you would be lower by about $4,400. But that's something you're never going to get the votes, because two towns are would go up and two towns would go down. So we go with the ed reform assessment.
Doug, could you make sure that they get the full budgets? Because I think that would be helpful, because we sent those to you.
Correct. And Dylan has them as well. The two full budgets, the PDFs?
We'll talk later about that, because I came and saw you this afternoon, and we talked about this exact issue.
These are really complicated figures and formulas. I know it's hard to get it on the fly, but I think once you have the figures in front of you, it seems to make more sense.
Yeah, I mean, I think, as you said, the different parts of the breakdowns are complicated, but I think for me, you know, I think the overall budgets are just, unfortunately, still concerning as to whether this school, like any other in the state, is long-term fiscally viable and what sort of path we're going down. I mean, for both this and elementary school, there's a handful of seeming, you know, one-off savings that are trying to hold us back from things we really cannot afford. And it just seems like it's a matter of time until one of those budgets comes our way.
It is very concerning. And I will tell you, at Frontier, because of the number of people that are retiring, we're going to be seeing a large number of savings due to those retirements, because we've been able to be hiring at a lower rate. And we're also combining some positions that currently have two people in that we're going to be going down. So the Frontier budget reflects a reduction in staff, as does the Deerfield budget. We can only keep reducing staff, and that's why I share your concern.
The especially concerning thing is that in years where you're reducing classes at the grammar school, reducing costs due to retirements at Frontier, we still have big budgets. Like, if these were years where the budgets were flat, and they say, okay, guys, in a couple years, this is going to burn off, we're going to be back to 2-3%, that's something you can kind of get your head around, but where's it going to go from here?
But
that's
we've
the
been
concern.
Flat.
See, we have.
We've
yeah,
been
last
flat,
year.
Though.
We were flat.
We had a decrease in Frontier last year. We had a 0%.
The overall school budgets for the last number of years, I don't believe, combined to be having been flat. On top of the maintenance we haven't been doing and the capital projects we haven't been putting aside all the money for.
Mm-hmm.
The cost to the town of the schools is still quite substantial year over year, and the increase to the taxpayer as a result of schools and projects for the schools is also substantial. Well, so I understand there's particular numbers you can pick out, or we could pick mm-hmm. out, but and I'm not castigating these particular budgets or your guys' preparation of them. It's just, it's very hard to know where we're going to go from here. And this isn't me saying the schools are doing a bad job. This mm-hmm. is me saying we're all in a fairly bad situation, and I don't know where the solution is going to come mm-hmm. from.
Correct. And everybody's feeling that, because the problem is that anywhere between 75-80% of our budgets are people. So when you are seeing us, when we reduce staff, okay, well then now let's get the money for the maintenance that we need, that we've been underspending, that's been underspent, that we've been over budget for. So the percent of things that we can cut besides people are very small. And then every year people anticipate a raise. So those are gonna go, that's yeah. gonna go up.
We know exactly how you feel, because 75-80% of the budget is the schools, and we can't cut much else, and every year this seems to go higher. So it's a microcosm of the way municipal finance is working, not of the way you're preparing your budget.
No,
so
I
this
understand.
Isn't a
right.
And I don't disagree with anything you've said.
This is the same, this conversation's happening in every town west of Worcester.
Sure. So what can we do?
Move to Boston.
Well, we've talked about some ideas tonight. You know, I mean, frankly, as far as consolidation, I gave you ideas about regionalization K through 6 that would give you more equitable classrooms. You'd have more shared services.
And as you quickly mentioned, it's not Deerfield that you're concerned about when you're regionalizing K-6.
But I think you can only keep going in this direction for so long before...
I perfectly understand.
You can't do anymore.
The financial model is not sustainable.
I've been trying for 30 years to do regionalization and have gotten slammed, just as you mentioned, starting back in the 80s. And I can remember having this conversation at the time with Bucky Storm and having him basically want to strangle me. We even suggested Conway and Whately get together and regionalize at that level. And it was like, there isn't any...
Well, I think there needs to be. We have a long-range planning committee established. I think they need to be reinvigorated to take a look at the regional agreement.
I agree.
To see if there's a big thing. What is that definition of insanity? Doing the same thing over and over again and expecting a different result is what we've been doing. And I think there needs to be some big ideas, and I think it needs to involve all four towns.
Well, you notice... And I'm kind of going back, but we all built new schools at essentially the same time. Was it because the schools that we had needed to be redone at that point in time? Or was this a way of, for some of the towns, to maintain their elementary schools? And I kind of think that was part of the,
At the time, the census indicators and the actual enrollment was incredibly high. You're talking about students who were born in the 80s. Mm-hmm. In the early 80s, and the projection was that we were going to continue that way for some time. I think it was a combination of both things that you said.
Yeah.
And unfortunately, we got to go.
So I just want to say one other thing to let the committee know was that there are some big expenses that are the district needs to pay for. One of them is a new student information system. The one that we have is outdated. It doesn't talk to our SPED database. It doesn't talk to our school lunch. It doesn't talk to the library system. So we have done a lot of research, and that is going to be about $50,000 capital outlay to replace that. But then annually, our fees will go down because they're based on number of students, not based on a number of licenses. So the school committee at Frontier voted to use excess and deficiency to fund that. The amount of money needed to take care of the retirement costs for the staff leaving this year and a few from last year was $185,490.
I know.
Again, they used the excess and deficiency. So we were only sitting at about $103,000 after everything was decided with the excess and deficiency.
Okay. One quick question. What would you need to do to get that 3.69 down to 2.5?
Cut a lot of money out of a budget that we don't have.
Right, but anything specific? Seeing how I don't have a full budget sitting
in front of me. You can't just do it without in isolation.
Right.
You would have to cut every other towns, and so you'd be talking multiple personnel.
Yeah, that's what we come down
to. It's not like just reducing Deerfield Elementary budget. It's
right,
not,
yeah.
So.
It come down to personnel.
Yeah.
Basically.
No, he's talking about the Frontier budget getting
down
from 369, not Deerfield.
No, I know that. Yeah.
So, Marty, I'm sure we're going to have a number of vacancies on the Finance Committee next year.
Oh.
Since you don't have anything to do.
I have travel plans.
Like you have the house.
I'm traveling way far away.
Thank you.
Thanks, Marty.
Thanks, guys. All right. Let's see. I'm not sure if Doug is printing out all the stuff we just went over.
He is.
Yeah. Skip, did you want to talk about the Franklin County Tech School? I know you had kind of taken a lead on.
Yeah.
One year they go to one town.
I'm only going to take about 2 minutes.
Because I sent
moves.
Around
yeah.
last week after
nobody
our meeting.
Yeah, you all have the requested amount for the Franklin County Tech School. it's down, and it's down because enrollments are actually, you know, when we say a lot, it's comparatively speaking.
Mm-hmm.
I guess I'm supposed to take that. But I think the thing that everyone needs to...
This is a full copy of elementary school budget that we didn't...
...understand or get a handle on is the capital projects at the tech school will be done this year, and the assessment for that will not occur in 2017, but will occur in 2018.
Mm-hmm.
So we won't have to worry about that. We don't know what that is. And it will be sometime this summer or this fall when we actually get that capital assessment. And how that's going to be, how they're going to fund it, I talked with the business manager, and they weren't sure. So I suspect they're going to bond. So we're just going to get hit with an annual assessment.
Mm-hmm. And so did you have any perspective when you were either talking to them or looking through that on how they're doing with capital projects? Is this the first of many? Are they staying on top of it?
They're doing several all at once.
Okay.
The roof, I
windows.
Guess there's...
Windows.
Yeah. Windows, blacktopping.
Yeah.
And so it was... I'll just throw out a number. It seemed to me it was in the $4 million range.
I went over there and took a look, and
yeah.
So nothing's not needed.
It needs it.
Well, yeah. They've been 40 years, and in part because they were able to do some of the work themselves.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
They, 75, so it's, 75, 40 years. So the roof has never been done,
right.
And they've maintained the roof.
Yep.
Been able to maintain the roof themselves, so. And I don't know whether they've been able to maintain the parking lots, but... So that's really, all ahead. I've got a copy of the budget. If anybody wants the budget, I think.
I'd send an email around. If someone wants a hard copy, we can get you one as well. My thought was on the elementary school and Frontier, as we're just getting the detail of the most recent budget, and Doug's passing them out, we'll vote those next week. So just give people a week to look through.
Yep.
If we have any more questions, we can follow up with email with Marty and Patty. And... start to get a better sense. I do understand the pressures that the schools are under, trying to constrain their costs, but it's a very tough reality that it's leaving the rest of the budget, assuming those types of increases on that bigger percent of it. Anyone have any disagreement with voting those two budgets next week?
No, I think that's a good idea.
Would people like to vote the tech school budget next week as well and take a look, or do people have... Okay. So we'll plan to vote those three next week.
Yep. When we do that, do we have the figures yet on tuition to Smith Volk?
Not yet.
Not yet. And it would be nice to have that one in too. I don't know whether there's any way of getting
Smith
that or Volk not.
Tuition.
I was hoping to get in touch with them today. I never got to it, but by the end of the week, I should be able to have numbers.
All right. So we have Mr. Kalaszewski was going to come in. I saw him earlier. I don't know if he's lurking.
I think he's in his office.
Okay. Do you want me to go get him?
Yeah, do you want to? That'd be, rather than us start something else, we can get him in and out and do the inspection salary and expense budgets. And then, Doug, after that, we can start to go back over some of the other ones, some of the Barbara accounts and other ones. I know you said you had some updates to yours as well.
And if I could get a copy of the trade school budget, I'd like that. I've been looking at it online, but it's hard. It's easier to read the hard copy.
Do you actually have?
I might have one. I can just have mine.
Because I've got one. It's in the truck. I can make a copy of it.
I was going to print it, but then I thought, oh my God.
Yeah, I went both pages.
Yeah, so many pages.
It's 25 pages, right?
Let me see.
There's that.
But
make a copy.
Oh, good. Okay, yeah, thanks, Skip.
Thank you, Skip. Anyone else need a copy while he's making them?
Yes, me.
What's
the name? Franklin Tech School physical copy of their budget.
Careful there, Richard.
He wants one. I want one.
I sent around the email.
Yeah.
If someone wants a hard copy, so I guess three. Skip.
Three, I guess. Skip.
You might as well make it four, Skip. I did review it on the email. Thank you, Dylan.
No problem.
I was going to, and then I go, oh my God.
Oh, yeah. All right. It's time for the inspection salary.
Good evening, Richard.
All right, so the first one we're going to be going through, guys, is account number 241-5400.
What's this one? It's just
extras. Just extras. I'll give them the dump. Here's some extras on Frontier.
Yeah, that's one.
Oh, that's just one?
Yeah.
Oh.
Two.
Two, I thought, yeah.
Does everyone have one of these already, Frontier budget?
241-5400,
inspection salaries.
How long were you looking for again?
241-5400.
Inspections, 41. Salaries. Does everybody have, anybody have this?
Yep. No?
I get it.
How do we not have this? Okay, well, I'll tell you what. Why don't we do, if you have 5410, the expense?
241-5400 is on the back or front of the
police one.
Police, yeah. Capital request 210-58XX.
Yep.
Thank you, Skip.
It's very likely your numbers are off.
Okay. All right. Does everybody have the one that we're going to be looking at, even if our numbers are off?
5400.
We're going to start with. Salaries.
5400.
Okay.
Dylan, what do you have for a bottom line on that budget?
I have 116,288.
That is okay. Richard,
I have.
You have 116?
Yeah, 116,288.
Right.
The last one we had. What have you got?
108,897.
Oh.
I like yours better.
Ooh, that's a good one.
Yeah, no, it isn't better if.
You're right. You deducted that, but I never got a copy of it.
Okay.
Okay, what line item changed, Doug?
Allow me to go through the numbers. The under commissioner, this is after consulting with Richard on this for a variety of reasons. We set the commissioner's salary at G6 step one for a total figure of 60,239. That's
okay.
G6 step one full time, 2088 hours.
Okay, what are the other line items before
the inspector of buildings, 8850, and I'm going in order.
Yep.
Inspector wiring, 14,000.
Yep.
Inspector plumbing and gas, 7,000.
Yep.
Inspections department clerk, 18808, I believe.
Okay. So it's just the first one that we were different on?
Probably.
I'm saying yes, that
the
was.
The first one, 60,239.
Wait, zero.
Well, maybe, yeah, sure.
Okay, so why don't we start by
meeting? We're just gonna.
If you want to do it, or Doug, you want to do it, talking about the inspector shifts, the 14,000 and 7,000, which are new line items.
Yeah, I can talk about that so you can understand it.
Yep.
We were mandated by the state through insurance inspections that they do to have record-keeping hours for plumbing, wiring, building inspector, and we got audited, and we failed the audit. So we had to bring all that in-house for the record-keeping. These are all paid 100% out of the revolving fund. So
basically now we have the permits coming into local receipts.
That is correct.
And paying the inspectors on this budget here. So even though these
correct.
Are expenses on the budget, they're being paid for.
Every single item on this page is paid through permit fees.
Mm-hmm.
There's not a penny that goes from taxation.
Yep.
Okay. So I'll clarify that.
We're talking 5,400.
Yep. Okay. This was the change. The first line, 62,39.
Yeah.
The others were accurate.
And I'll clarify the increase in the commissioner's salary. That is not a increase in salary. That is anticipation of someone else in that position at some time.
It's on the back of the police department capital.
210, okay.
What's the matter?
No.
Okay. Could everybody hear that? Wow. Talking about the increase to the salary of the commissioner?
I didn't hear that.
Okay, so why don't you say it again?
I'll say it again.
Yeah.
The increase you see in salary there is not an increase in my salary. That is an anticipation of someone else in that position at some point.
So how much is your increase, son? How much is your increase?
None.
So you're getting 46, yeah. 345?
That is correct.
This is 210.
Approximately, yes. Within a few pennies. That is correct. This is...
Are you talking about bringing a whole person into this?
I didn't hear you.
Are we talking about a whole person in this position as opposed to doing...
Yes. We are talking about separating two positions.
So let's say that it goes through at 6239 and you stay on for 6 months. And then just making up a number, and then they bring in somebody at 6239 for the second 6 months.
It'll be a surplus.
Okay, so you're so you're staying
absolutely
where you are.
Be a surplus.
So it's just budgeting for the flexibility.
Nothing will change with the hourly rate.
Gotcha.
Okay.
Okay.
The only thing that could change in the future mm-hmm. is splitting two positions up there's only like two people in the state of Massachusetts to do both of those functions.
To be clear, you're talking about inspector and Board of Health, right?
Yeah, that is correct. Yep. Yeah. So. Sorry, Doug, I forgot about we went over this before.
I don't know.
I just didn't do a reprint.
The only question I really have here is, what's going to show up on the omnibus budget article for
This line?
Yeah.
108,897.
Okay. And then for funding of the omnibus budget article, there's going to be a small portion or $30,000, give or take, or more, would be funded from a revolving fund.
The omnibus budget article doesn't have any information regarding revenues. That being said, we anticipate a $55,000 increase to our revenue line item because the inspection fees for plumbing and wiring are now going directly into our revenue line item.
No more revolving
instead
fund.
Of being in a revolving fund.
At the end of the omnibus budget article, there's funding sources. There's several funding sources. One of them would be, I would anticipate that there would be something in there from out of this revolving fund.
Correct, but actually, because of the way we've done it, because of the way we're working it, we won't be using the revolving fund. The fees and things are going directly into the general budget, general revenues. So it won't say X dollars out of a revolving fund. It will simply...
It must be, yeah.
Okay.
That's part of our general appropriation. In the same way that right now our building inspection fees are going directly into general appropriation. If that makes sense. Anticipated
general fund.
But you're saying these are coming from revolving, so it's got to show somewhere.
They're no longer going to be in revolving.
Right. We will not be reauthorizing the revolving fund. In order to clarify the way monies are being spent in this department, this was the only way that we could
control.
And this was what was recommended by Brenda and through her a couple of different consultants, actually. So, which is part of the reason why our revenue line item is actually considerably higher this year than.
Okay. So, or the local receipts.
Local receipts is 55,000 higher. Yeah.
Yeah, it took a while. Sorry.
Now, Doug, can you speak to historically when we've had potential staffing changes, retirements, replacements, whatever? Is this what we've typically done in the past of, you know, pre-funding a budget for a potential hire in the coming fiscal year? Or can anyone on this board answer, you know, what's been done in the past in these types of situations?
I do know that funding levels are maintained for a position, even if the position is vacant. I do know that in at least one other case, I can think of a position that did not have someone in it at the time that the budget was presented, but it was funded at a certain level in anticipation of that position being filled.
Because obviously this position is funded, it just may need to be funded at a different level to the extent that somebody else comes in, and the two ways to accomplish that are to fund it at what you think the anticipated level is, knowing you may end up with some surplus, or fund it at the existing level, knowing that you may have to come back to the Finance Committee for a reserve fund transfer for the additional salary to the extent that that's required.
Well, we did look at that. We looked at that as a possibility. However, one thing that Kat Dolan has been working on extensively over the past couple of days in our office is actually taking what salary information that we have in our budget and comparing it to other towns in our area, what is being paid, to try to come up with averages, not only for this position, but for others. And just taking a quick look at her work so far, we're currently budgeting for a building commissioner for FY17 at, I think, $28.85 an hour. Is that what that number turns out to be?
I believe you're right, Doug.
It says 32.30 something.
That's not what the 60 is.
Inspection salary. I'm sorry. Let me go back to that particular. What we're proposing for next year is G6 Step 1 or $28.85 an hour. For the inspector, for the building commissioner. Regionally, the average for a building commissioner is $28.54 an hour. So we think that our estimate is right in line with what regionally folks are doing.
Are you changing the grade?
Grade 6.
It says 5.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, they're changing it to grade 6, step 1. I understand that.
Oh,
it said
right.
5,
that
step
does 10. Say grade 5.
Yeah.
We didn't take that into account, Richard. Are we going up a grade?
No.
Grade 5, step 1 is $21.63 an hour.
Yeah.
You will not hire a building commissioner for $21.63 an hour.
Yeah. Okay.
If I can throw out a couple of other averages. A plumbing inspector, the average salary regionally is 35 an hour. Wiring is 35 an hour. And I believe there is a building inspector in this list as well. And I'm sorry, I don't see it. Wow, they don't have one. Okay.
All right, well, I think that makes sense in terms of the work you've done, Dick's input on, you know, what the cost of this type of position has been in other areas and could be here. How do other people in the committee feel about the choices of budgeting to what we're going to get to and potentially having surplus if the person doesn't start right away or even at all during the next year, or budgeting to what we have now, knowing that we may have to come back later and put more money in if the salary ends up being more next year?
My only question is, if I remember, Mary, you probably are a lot more familiar with it than I am. What does the personnel bylaw say about hiring somebody in?
They're supposed to come in at step one of the grade.
Yeah.
But that's the reason for getting the classification schedule increased or changed or whatever. Yeah. Because if that original one was for grade 6, this one here is grade 5.
Right. Right. And we can budget it at grade 5, step 1. We will be coming back for a transfer request if we do that.
But it won't be as much as we don't put it in now.
But wait, wouldn't we be budgeting at grade five, step 10 plus at the lowest? Why would we budget for lower than that?
Because we don't start people at step 10 plus.
No, I know that, but we have someone there now.
At $31 an hour, correct. Who's been working diligently for the town for many, many years.
Absolutely,
yeah.
But in absence of anything else, wouldn't we be putting in that budget for that line item at this point, knowing that we don't know yet what the cost will be?
How is your salary split between building inspector, building commissioner, whatever, and do you remember what the percentages are? It's the same hourly rate, right?
The same hourly rate. It's, I think, 12 hours or 14 hours for 12 hours, I think,
yeah.
Goes on
so
the
this,
health board, and
yeah.
The rest of it goes on the inspection. You can just level fund it and then go back again. You could do that. Or you can do it. Either way, it's a numbers game because it all comes out of permit fees. So
that's up. We got to vote it, though.
Yeah, I know.
To me, I lean towards level funding it mostly because we're not addressing the number of shortcomings of our current classification schedule. And so as soon as you start saying, well, but this one will handle on its own, there's probably 10 other things that mm-hmm. we need to handle on their own.
Yeah.
And if we're waiting to get that done, to make that go forward, and level funding it doesn't stop us from having someone who's here now, potentially bring in someone if we need someone else, and potentially funding that excess if we need to get to that point, that's where I kind of land on that side for that reason. To me, the biggest challenge here, and we talked about this a little bit earlier, was we've been, I think, very fortunate, we've definitely been very fortunate to have someone who could fulfill both roles. Can we find somebody who can fulfill both roles, or will we have to ultimately split these into two separate full-time, or one full-time and one part-time position?
Yeah.
That's, I think, the bigger challenge that we face, not so much for this budget here, but for
down the road,
next year, FY18's budget.
So if you're talking about level funding, are you talking about level funding the rate per hour or the funding for that particular line in the budget?
Well, what I would say is taking the commissioner's line item and having the FY16 number with a COLA adjustment to whatever that comes out to, because it's step 10 plus, and have that be that line item. Then leave the other four as they stand, the 8850, 14,000, 7,000, and 18808.
Okay. Specifically, I'm asking if you're keeping the rate per hour the same, or if you're keeping the total for the year appropriation for the commissioner the same.
The number of hours the same.
Number of hours.
That's the question. Are you going to keep it at 28 hours a week?
Yeah, that's what.
That's what it is.
That's what we're saying.
Yeah.
And that's what Dylan is saying.
Okay. Then that actually is not what we were looking to do. We're looking to increase this to a full-time position.
Okay.
Which I can do, stay within grade five, step two, $22.44 an hour.
You won't find anybody.
But you won't find anybody.
That's
so,
well, what do we think? Would anybody's preference be to have it be two positions rather than one position?
Well, I think it is
two positions.
It is two positions. He's just been doing it. Yeah.
But the likelihood of finding someone that could do both is next to it. Won't have the certifications aren't there.
How many towns in the area don't have their own board of health?
None.
I mean, independent.
Board of health is required by law.
I mean, independent of not the select board, but a separate board.
How many have that, a separate board?
Yeah.
Couldn't answer.
Probably 75%. It's rare to find the select board and the Board of Health jointly in a town of this magnitude.
Right.
Yeah.
And so in towns that don't have that, do they then just outsource someone to come in and do those inspections?
That's exactly what happens.
They
outsource the inspections because of certifications. Okay, but they still maintain a Board of Health, but the Board of Health is not active in any role.
Gotcha.
Yeah.
There are two towns in Franklin County that maintain independent, I believe, correct me if I'm wrong, two towns that maintain independent inspections offices, Greenfield and Montague. I think all the other towns in Franklin County are served by the Council of Governments and the Cooperative Inspection Services.
Sunderland, too, is.
Sunderland has its own inspector?
Yeah.
Okay. I didn't check Sunderland. I believe that inspector's part-time. Greenfield Montague's inspectors are full-time. Greenfield pays $70,000 a year. Montague pays $60,000 a year for just their for their building inspector. And I assume that person is serving in the role as commissioner.
Are they commissioners? Are they commissioners?
Yes, you that's the other issue. You can't hire a building inspector. You have to have the higher certification, and the town is mandated to have a building commissioner, every town. Or you can't hire a building inspector only. The state, they have rules for steps that you got to go through.
I believe that Northampton has a separate commissioner, but that's because they have two or three separate building inspectors.
Two separate inspectors. Greenfield has three building inspectors. Northampton has three building inspectors. Amherst has three building inspectors.
And each one of them, one of those three, is the commissioner.
One of them is. The other two aren't. Greenfield has three full-time Board of Health people. Northampton has, I believe, three also.
So I guess we're at a point where it's, you know, there needs to be some discussion in the town about what do we do. Because I agree, we're not going to find somebody to do both these roles at once. And we, you know, we may look at changing the format of how we have, we're having a real...
Well, you're right. This was the start of that. This was to move forward in that direction. But I mean, if you're... Financially, I guess, if you really got an issue, just do the same rate as last year with a COLA, and when somebody pops comes out of the woodwork, deal with it then.
Well, Richard, are you talking the same rate at the same hours?
Yeah.
With the COLA, yes.
So that's going to be like 47 or whatever
plus,
that is. Yeah. Doug, if you increase the hours but had to go to the... grade 5, step 1, wouldn't you be in about the same zip code anyway?
I'm sorry, say that question again.
So if we keep it as it is and just do the COLA, you're going to be at around 47,000, give or take, right? If you went to the full-time hours but had to go to the grade 5, step 1, aren't you going to be in about the same spot?
Yeah, that's true, but that's a non-existent person.
So does it help you any to do that?
If you advertise this position as 28 hours a week at $32.24 per hour, which is the step 10 plus with a COLA, you may actually get applicants for it. Because someone would be also able to serve as a building inspector for another smaller town, or perhaps a part-time inspector for the COG or something along those lines.
Yeah.
If you advertise this position at grade 5, step 2 or 3 full-time, the bottom line would be the same. You'd be about $46,000 or $47,000 a year, and you would not be able to fill it because that would preclude the person from being able to do inspection services elsewhere.
Sure.
So there's that.
Would the first step be to try to find somebody to come in for 40 hours to do both roles? Like, is that as unlikely as it is to find someone that can do that?
You're talking about inspector and commissioner.
I'm talking about...
And health agent?
No, I'm talking about commissioner... building inspector, building commissioner, and Board of Health.
Yeah.
Basically, what Mr. Kalashevsky is doing now, as difficult as it is to find someone who can deal with the certifications, is there a plan to try to find that before moving on to another arrangement?
I think the first question would be is there a plan for the person who's doing those roles right now to vacate both roles? And my understanding is that we weren't talking about that. I could be wrong.
I don't know what the plan is. That's why I'm trying to
Any deeper that into that conversation, I think it needs to be taken offline and privately, but...
there is no plan.
I have a question.
Okay.
Dick, do you think somebody else could do that, what you've been doing?
Well, to get...
Keep them, I mean?
To get the building commissioner's certification takes a lot.
I know.
It's very time-consuming, okay? And to get to be a building inspector is time-consuming. The state has raised the bar on what you can, what your credentials have to be. Okay, mm-hmm. You have to have a 4-year bachelor's degree in construction type engineering type work. You have to have 5 years supervisory experience holding a construction license in lieu of that. to just be able to take the exams, okay? Then you've got to do 6 different exams, which are not easy, okay? The failure rate is about 50% for each exam, designed that way to make the bar higher, okay? The Board of Health, same scenario. There's different licenses that you hold from the Board of Health also, which have the same thing. For example, soil evaluator's license for doing perk test or monitoring perk test, they hold the classes about once a year, okay? So if you don't have one, it'll take you a year before you can go to the class, which is 1 day a week, I think, for 6 weeks, or 2 days a week for 6 weeks, then plus take the state exam. So, and then there's the inspector's license, which has about the same thing. Then it's the 45 hours of continuing education for the building inspector, and either 10 or 12 hours for the Board of Health to maintain your certifications.
So it's difficult.
It's a lot.
Yeah.
And it just, you got to be ready to do that.
Well, let me ask you this different question. Do you think, obviously they've split out the hours between the two things that you do in a certain way.
Mm-hmm.
Do you think that that's pretty reflective of the time spent in those, like roughly? Obviously it changes week to week.
To be really honest with you, in January or December, the Board of Health is
quiet.
Slower.
Yeah.
Okay?
Mm-hmm.
In the summertime, there's failed septic systems and other things. And then one of the things that becomes real burdensome is when somebody files a housing complaint and you're tied up in housing court for hours upon hours. I won't mention the name of the infamous farm labor camp, but that was days and days and days in Superior Court in Springfield. Okay. Those are the kind of things you're faced with that then you fall behind on the rest of the job.
Sure. And the reason I'm asking is just, do you, like, let's pretend that we're looking to bring in somebody for, is it 28 a week? Is that how it's broken out for the 28 hours? Do you think that they could do the job in that amount of time if that's all they were brought in for and that was all they're on the clock for?
No.
Okay.
No. And the reason I say that is a familiarization with all the people you have to deal with.
Yeah.
And there's another little issue that's going to crop up. Deerfield Academy is planning some serious renovations starting the next fiscal year, which will continue on for 3 to 5 years. So down the road, it will take somebody quite a bit to maintain that.
Well, it's decided you're going to have to stay.
Yeah.
It solves all the problems.
If we had the cog for our commissioner.
That can't happen.
Why? How do the other towns do it?
Because they... for one thing, they get about $80 an hour from portal to portal. Mm-hmm. Okay, that's the first problem. The second problem is that I don't know how to word it, but without familiarization for the town, you wind up missing, overlooking some serious issues. Okay, that can come back and bite you.
Mm-hmm.
The COG only does little towns. They don't do zoning enforcement, okay, which is a major factor.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So it's another layer of government, so to speak. We average, on an average day, I average between 15 and 20 phone calls a day for different things, okay? You know, it's almost humorous that if I go to Springfield, somebody stops me in the street from Deerfield and wants to know about something, or they drive up to your house, okay?
Yeah.
If I may ask a question, what about the idea of outsourcing the Board of Health agent instead?
Same situation.
Right.
Same situation. It's a
higher rate.
The reason I got the Board of Health job to start with in 2001, Mr. Pachurik might remember, in 2001, we had a budget that was between 30 and 40,000 for Board of Health.
Mm-hmm.
And it was used up 100%. Okay? I stepped into the Board of Health job for somewhere between 10 or 12,000. Displacing the 40,000 or 35 or 40,000, whatever wow. was expended at the time.
If I can sort of interject a little bit, Bill, John, and I attended that conference a year and a half ago, Finance Committee conference in October. And one of the things that we all heard, and I think this is an example of it, is the comment that I'm not sure who it was that made it, whether she was a selectman or whatever, but her comment was that towns of less than 10,000 population really can't long stay in business because they won't be able to afford the cost of maintaining the services that they need to provide in large measure because the changes in both state and federal requirements. This is an example of it. 20 years ago, the job could be done much more easily than it could be done today.
Mm-hmm.
50 years ago, no one did it.
1972 was almost non-existent.
40 years ago.
I just pulled the building permit out from 1976 the other day. The building permit fee for building a new house, $5.
Okay.
$5.
So. Well, unfortunately, I think that's
part-time.
Well, unfortunately, I think that's what's driving a lot of these issues. Is you have the permit mm-hmm. fees, and then you also have the fees and associated costs of all the education that all the people are being forced to go and do, and you know the people making money on that. So that's.
I guess the point I should go back to is all this Board of Health and all the building inspector and all these fees, including Priscilla's salary and all the rest of them, are 100% funded by permit fees. So.
And how much extra goes into that?
Even a little bit more.
How much what?
How much extra goes into it over and above these fees? A couple hundred thousand?
It varies from year to year.
The inspection salaries are about $105,000. The inspection expense about $7,000. The I'm looking for it. Where is it? Board of Health salary and expense together are about 60. So you're looking at maybe $185,000. We have in our revenue line items under local receipts for licenses and permits, we have $215,000 anticipated for next year, and that's conservative. So you're talking about $30,000 to $40,000 in extra revenue coming in. And I'll stand behind that.
And
the inspections department is the one department in town that actually makes money, pays for itself, and makes
money. Last year, I think 200 went into free cash from inspections fees. One check I got from one of the schools was $200,000 this past year for fees. So.
I guess I would suggest, since, I mean, we haven't talked about it, but I think there's a suggestion or a recommendation coming up that the reserve account be enhanced. Is that a good word? Increased? And that if we take the existing budgets and raise it by some percentage or cost of living, and leave it at that, and then at that point in time we can come back and increase
the budget. I'll increase it by 1.7%. If you're going to go up from 80,000 to 100,000,
Well, no, I'm talking about the reserve. It's not good. The recommendation isn't going to be 1.7.
Two separate things. First of all, there is a reserve account conversation we can have later.
Yeah.
I don't think that it is set, and I actually oppose increasing the reserve account, but we can talk about that later. Back to this, the argument I would make for having it be increased is it will necessitate, I think, a good conversation at town meeting about this, about what we're going to do. And honestly, I think that the extra $5,000 in the budget, whatever increase you want to put in here, is worthy of beginning that conversation.
Mm-hmm.
I'm not sure what the best way is to do this, because Doug, again, if you have to go full-time step five or grade five step one, you're actually lower than if we just go 1.7% higher on the existing salary. So what would you like to do?
If you go full-time, 2088 hours a year, grade five, step three, that's $2,324 an hour, or $48,525 for the year.
But who's saying we're picking step three?
I'm trying to find a step that is comparable to a mild increase for that line. G5 step two is $46,855 per year.
I don't disagree with you that that may end up being a most appropriate thing, but I don't know that I feel entirely comfortable again with taking a larger process of the classification schedule and starting to move stuff around to make it work.
I'm sorry, then tell me what it is you're suggesting. I don't understand.
I'm saying I'm open to having this be more than a 1.7% increase, because I do think it would bring about a conversation that would be very good to have at town meeting about this position, what it's going to be in the future, and
so
what our options are.
So just benchmark it with 4% or something?
And so my question for you is, what is the best practical way to get there if we can avoid having to just pick a grade and a step that solves for a number? Is there a way we could do just a 1.7% increase and put in another line item with a reserve or something in here for that potential future hire that gets us away from classification, but gives us the flexibility and brings about the conversation we want to have?
Good idea.
What you should do then is take his salary now, add the 1.7% to it, leave it in there, add another line item underneath, increase for replacement commissioner.
I feel much more comfortable with that too. I agree with Dylan as far as, you know, the grades and the steps could get us in trouble.
1462 hours a week, G5,
you got everything in it.
Step 10 plus.
So that will benchmark it as a new line item.
Yeah. I'm going to put this in here. It's got to go before the Board of Selectmen for approval, because I guess I'm trying to figure out. I mean, we presented a budget that we thought made sense, but now you want to put in a reserve in a salary budget in case it's needed?
Well, it's revolving anyway.
The replacement thing.
Replacement.
It's not.
Rick said he's going to retire. It's not 5 years from now, but he wants to get you used to the idea.
And it seems like.
So you have commissioner, then you put down a second line underneath it for.
Well, that's, I guess
that's commissioner who would not be part-time, who would not have only 28 hours per week, but would be a 35 or a 40-hour week employee. So you want to beef it up between the two of them to get it up to the 55 or 60,000.
That's where we started.
I would trim it.
I'm going to go back to what we had when this.
Doug, or we could maintain that additional amount if needed to come out of a transfer from the reserve account. But I still think we want to have this conversation.
Huh?
Okay. We're actually not going to have
it.
You are not going to have it at town meeting.
Now we have to have a line.
Yeah. If you want to come before the Board of Selectmen and advise them as to how you want them to structure the inspections department in association with the current building commissioner, that's certainly the purview of any individual. But the finance committee doesn't dictate the operations of any given town department.
Well, hold on a second. I'm not telling anybody how to organize any department, Doug.
Okay.
All I'm saying is I think this is a very important conversation, and if we could have it at town meeting, that would be great. I am very open to many different ways in which we can accomplish that goal. The one thing I don't like is throwing in grades and steps to solve for a number, because we're not doing that in a whole number of other places, and I don't would like to not do it here, especially if we don't have to.
How about if we put in the 1.7 against the salary now and then have another line item for the difference of the...
And I understand Doug's point that to include another line item, Doug, we're not telling you to do it now. We're saying bring this back to the board. Let's see what other ideas that you and they have about this. Because, look, the simplest way to do it is just transfer out a reserve if we need the money, right? Then this budget stays 1.7% higher. We're all on the same page that we may need to bring in someone full-time. We're going to need extra money to do that, and we're all willing to have that conversation if and when it happens.
Sure. Thank you.
Sure, put me on the spot. I would approach it a little bit different.
Sure.
Okay. I would approach it, if you want to put a third line item in, I would approach it, that third line item is an anticipation for increased business, we'll call it, from the private school construction that will happen in fiscal 17 and 8, or 18 and 19.
We have option 4. Anyone for option 5? Sure, go for it.
Okay, well, so we have a range somewhere between FY16 plus 1.7% and some higher number that we're going to get to through one of a few different ways. Does anybody have any questions, comments, or concerns about these other line items in this budget?
The only thing is, no one's going to see this. The only thing they're going to understand is the increase. Mm-hmm. And the only way they're even going to say, why is that increase? I mean, they're because they don't see the detail.
Somebody's going to raise their hand and say,
put a hold on it, yeah.
Put a hold on it. Tell us why.
Right. Yep. And so it's going to start with a conversation about the revolving fund not being reauthorized
right. And
adding those expenses into this budget. And that can certainly transition into a larger conversation about this role in the hours and where we go from there. So perhaps this conversation can happen regardless of if we have a separate line item for the salary.
It's not going to happen on town meeting floor. The voters just, you know, they don't have enough information going in to even, you know, other than why did it go up? Well, we've changed the way we're doing things and whatever the question is, and then it's going to be yes or no. There's not going to be significant, even though we might like to have a significant discussion. It just isn't going to happen.
So
that's a discussion that we need to have with the Board of Selectmen, and so that we're all on the same page when we go to town meeting, preferably.
Doug, correct me if I'm wrong, but Priscilla's position is a transfer out of the Selectmen's office.
Correct.
So the Selectmen's budget has dropped.
That happened last year.
Last year.
And so this isn't really, her part isn't an increase.
Yeah, it's just the inspectors.
The increase is explained for two reasons. The two inspections, inspector staff, the wiring, plumbing, and gas, the two positions there, are being funded from the general appropriation instead of being funded out of the revolving fund. These are not new positions. These have always happened. The funding has always been there in the revolving fund. The corresponding increase in our revenue estimates is because we're now putting those fees that they earned or that they charged for their inspections directly into our general revenue. Mm-hmm. That results in a net gain to our bottom line, not a net loss. We're going from a 28-hour position to a 40-hour position for our building commissioner or building inspector. That joint position is being funded at step one, G6. And the reason it's being funded at step one, G6, and the reason why I'm planning to go before the personnel committee to fight for that reclassification is because while the inspections department chair or the head of the department, the building commissioner, does functionally respond to the office of the town administrator, he acts independently. He answers to a higher authority, being that of state law. He abides by the building code. And his decisions are only appealed at the state level, correct me if I'm wrong, or the housing court. If he makes a decision that's inaccurate, it could drag the town into significant liability. And there's no oversight from anyone elsewhere in town government. Therefore, that person has to be able to have the skills and have the training to be able to do the job sufficiently and to protect the interests of the town. In all other cases where a person acts with that much independence and with so little authority, the person is classified at grade 6. The town clerk, the police chief, superintendent of public works, and the town administrator.
Okay.
So that's going to be my justification for putting it at grade 6. And I think step one, which again matches up almost to the dollar as to what other building commissioners are getting or other building inspectors are getting in our area, I think it's a fair placement.
So grade six, step one, at 2088 hours, that's 6239?
60239, yes.
Okay.
Doug, are we supposed to be meeting with the select board, the finance committee?
We're trying to get a date and time that that can happen, but yes.
To discuss budget here?
The agenda, I think, is still being worked out, but yes. Broadly speaking, yes.
I want to get back to this just because I want to take up Dick's time. We are looking to do that. We don't have a date set, so we'll definitely get to that, and that's a high priority for all of us to have that meeting.
Just a bit of trivia for you.
Sure.
10 years ago, the building commissioner's salary was the line item that it is today, plus a half-time person. There were 60 hours allotted to the building inspectors 10 years ago.
Okay.
Good thing that building slowed down.
Yeah, it's a good thing, isn't it?
That's a real good
inspector. Was a wild and crazy guy. Remember him?
Oh, yes. Asman.
Yeah. Mary, what are your thoughts on transition or changing this to grade six, step one? Doug kind of gave, and I know you don't speak for the whole personnel board, but just given your experience on it.
By giving the justifications that he just gave, I would see no problem with it, with changing it. But again, we're working on the schedule now. It's kind of hard for us to even come up with any grades or anything.
Right, but you'd use the same methodology that they've used, so.
Yeah, because if you go to the layout we have now, it definitely would put him in a grade 6, not a problem.
Well, then what do people think about voting this budget as it has been presented? Obviously, there is this difference between, let's say, 47,000 and 60, that if we get a better overview of the budget and we're realizing that that is kind of the difference between something that we really need, we can revisit it?
Yeah.
I think it's okay.
So what are we...
This would be
saying?
To vote the budget as presented, which had the first line of 6239, which is grade 6, step 1, as a full-time position. And again, this would just be in the budget, not necessarily what we'd be expending, depending on
right.
whether you know who the commissioner was and for how long.
I think there's all good intentions here, and everybody's working hard at it, and I think it's reality.
And so with that being said, total budget line, total appropriation would be?
It would be 108,837.
837.
I've got 108,896.
Thought you had 897.
Oh, sorry.
Sorry, 897.
897, sorry. Yep. Read my own writing.
897. 108,897.
Yep.
That's correct.
I'll move.
Okay, moved and seconded. Before voting, one other thing to point out, just because we didn't touch on it, we're moving the inspector's hours from 25 to 30,
yep.
The second line item. So that mm-hmm. is the increase in that line item. The second line item, that's 88.50. The reason for the increase from the previous, from FY16 to that, is the hours increase.
Your motion still holds?
And
sure.
My second still holds.
Okay. And if I may ask one last question.
Right, to 30, yeah.
Mr. Kalaszewski, how do you feel about, like, can you talk to us about the increase in the hours, like where you see that in terms of how much that hour increase is needed? We've had some hour increase requests from other budgets that we've pushed back on, if not turned down. And certainly we see the value and the foresight with the commissioner position. And I'm just wondering how you feel the necessity on the inspector side in light of that.
Well, it's mostly due to the private school increases.
Yeah.
Right now, there's a $20 million project going on at Eagle Brook School. They're just putting the walls up now. That's a two-year project. I had a conversation with Deerfield Academy last week, and they're anticipating within the next fiscal year to have a major, I believe it's the hockey rink scenario, is just going to go down.
Mm-hmm.
And that's going to be a significant project. It just requires a lot of meetings, not an inspection process, more than it is a review process. Your previous people here, that project there is going to require pretty much a lot of time put into the roof project, following that up during June, July, and August.
Mm-hmm.
Right there is a major deal. So we have an increase in, we have some upchuck in housing stuff that's come along. We have two new, brand new houses. We have actually three new houses under construction. That's the most we've had in the past 5 or 6 years.
Yeah, and I hear you on that. It's just, you know, these are the things that are tough to put the genie back in the bottle. You know, if 2 years from now there's a lull in the
yep.
schools, then it's unlikely to see hours go back from 30 to 25. That's my hesitance.
And the one thing that is time-consuming, that it's unfortunate that it happens every three-year cycle, is this year is the cycle for major code upgrade from the building code. They skipped 3 years ago with doing the major upgrade. So we're working on a 2009 international code, which in July goes to a 2015 international code, which major learning cycle, major, you got to go through everything now to review it.
Okay.
So, Dick, just quickly,
you've
got 400 hours for a wiring inspector, 200 hours for a plumbing and gas inspector.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
Those are best guesstimates, but they could be more than that. And
it's
if
possible.
They are, then we would end up needing to probably do some sort of a transfer to get.
Yep. And I kept those to a reasonable, and I talked to both parties.
Yeah.
Okay. We kept those to a reasonable dollar amount.
And the other one's not reasonable, is that what you're saying?
Thanks. We kept those to a reasonable scenario.
No, I'm just saying and that, you know, if we need, you know, if it's 450 hours, then at some point in time you're going to have to come to get a transfer.
It's possible.
Yeah.
It's possible. We didn't have to do anything this past year. We're very fortunate. We have excellent inspector staff. I've gotten some major compliments on our plumbing and wiring inspector for, you know, being there on time and all that kind of stuff. So we haven't had any complaints. They're happy with what they're doing. They maintain office hours. So,
I just wanted to point
out
that, you know, with this kind of a budget where you're kind of making a best estimate possible for the number of hours.
Yeah.
It is an estimate, and it's you're not going to hit it exactly.
Nope.
So if we need to increase.
That increase would only come with an increase in revenue.
That's right.
So
right.
That's exactly, it's mm-hmm. permit driven. Mm-hmm. So every permit comes with a price attached to it.
Yeah.
We get every single week, we get 2 to 3 solar panel permits, for example, okay? They're every week now. So it's something we didn't have before. 2 years ago, one a month. Now we get 2 to 3 a week. And so revenue increase from that, inspection increase. And the time that the inspectors take is generally covered pretty well by the fees to collect it. So,
all right. Well, we have a Sorry.
Just one last quick question, Dick. You spoke to these people just recently as far as rates and everything?
Yep.
Okay.
Yeah, they're very happy with what they're doing. The comment I got from one of them, or both of them, was that they're glad to work for the town to help serve the town. So,
okay.
It's like anybody's been in the past, the same way. You know, they're working for the town. So, no, they're, as far as I know, they're happy in the job.
Okay.
So,
thank you.
All right, so we had a motion and was seconded for 108,897 for inspection salary. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Aye.
All those opposed? I'm going to oppose. I would like to see that stay at 25. I think there'd be the flexibility within the budget, but I support the committee's vote.
Did you oppose?
I did. I did oppose.
He did that for political reasons.
Those are the notes you gave me for tonight, was oppose the...
I know, I want to make sure you're reading them.
Okay.
Could you clarify? You said, I would like to see that stay at 25?
The inspector, I think keeping that at 25 hours...
Oh, at 25 hours, okay.
Then there'd be, you know, if the new commissioner didn't start July 1st, every day you'd have excess built into the budget with which you could backfill to additional hours for the inspector if he needed it.
But I see what you're saying.
It's a smaller point, so I'm not going to hold this up anymore. All right, building inspection expense.
25.
That is 100% driven by new code books.
241-5410. This one should be a lot more straightforward.
Do we have that here somewhere?
Go in if you don't, you look right here.
241-5410.
Richard, what do you have
back
for a bottom line
page.
Number?
What's that?
Back in the next page.
Yeah, it's right after the one we're just looking at, wherever you were.
95.
Page you were at. The very next page on the back side.
Wait, what is that? K9. Oh, yours isn't that way. So yours going backwards?
Maybe I need to go back.
I think you're going the other way. I think it's the next page then. All right, well, here, it's right here.
It's all right. Yeah, I'll work on yours.
Okay, Doug, we have $6,795.
Yep.
Okay.
It's 100% driven by new code books that I just explained for 2015, plus mandatory attendance to plumbing and wiring seminars for maintained certification. That's it in a nutshell.
And Doug, the only question I had was, now these are things we've had to do some years in the past. The new code books was last...
Yep.
Do you know what budget year that would have been, I guess?
Makes sense. They skipped three, so
skipped three, so it would have been
5 or 6 years.
I guess that'd be FY11, so we don't have that on here. Okay.
We were not paying for those services in the past, right?
We said these come once every so many years. You have to buy new code books. But it's so far back that we don't have any data.
I just wondered, were we buying code books before, or was this... What was expected of the person?
It's mandatory you have a code book in the office, that you have code books.
This is in your office?
Yep.
Okay.
There's approximately 15 code books for the building inspection, plus the electrical code books and the plumbing code books.
And so just to be clear, you would anticipate that next year's budget would not have these line items? Because
next year's budget will be significantly lower.
Perfect.
Yeah.
Okay.
It's in a 3-year cycle.
But we had it in the budget prior to the last 3 budgets.
No,
they said they
skipped the...
Yeah, there's always upgrades or a different book that's come out. Perfect example is they never had a sheet metal code. Then they came out with a sheet metal code. Mm-hmm. So we had to buy a sheet metal code book.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
And they're always changing something or coming out with something. Unfortunately, they take parts of the building code overlap with the fire code. So now you have to buy a fire code book because the building code refers to the fire code, see section such and such, chapter such and such. And you have to have that book to cross-reference it.
Sure. Any other questions on this one?
No.
Yes. Sure. Warrant inspector, why do you have $1,000 in there?
Continuing education and code books.
Why continuing education? They don't go that on their own?
No.
Did they go on their own?
they did before when they were getting 90% of the salary.
Yeah. I look back better. In the history of that. We don't want to go back to that.
I'm willing to pay the $1,000.
Yeah. Yeah.
To be honest, that $1,000 figure is, it's not quite a shot in the dark, but it's an estimate. Yeah. And we hope to refine the number next year.
And I notice you have in here health inspector, $1,000.
Same thing.
The question I have is, why is it in the building department versus in the...
Where is
it's
it?
Actually a really good question.
Hmm? Oh.
Health inspector, why don't we have it in the health department?
Quickly checking.
Didn't catch that.
Did you double dip?
Oh, is that what it is?
Actually, that probably could be eliminated. That may very well have just been an oversight on my part.
Okay. Is it in the health?
The health inspections budget, the expense budget is just fine. Yeah, thank you very much.
Is.
Yeah.
That's
so
that was just a typo.
We're going to get rid of that. It's a $1,000 typo.
There you go.
Yeah, that's okay. Good catch.
Which makes the bottom line 5795 instead of 6795.
Got one more question.
Well, we're going to lose another $1,000. Watch.
Mm-hmm. No.
You got to limit
vehicle expense.
What expense?
Vehicle expense. At one time, you talked about taking an old cruiser and using that for making inspections. Has any of that ever materialized?
Yeah.
So you have an old cruiser that you use to make your inspections?
It is used for all different people.
It is?
Yes.
So what does the six... What does a 675 cover? Grease oil filter?
And yeah, grease oil filter gas.
Who puts the fuel in that?
Jointly.
Depends on who uses it.
We have a fuel card, and whoever's using it puts the fuel in it. But it's used by several. It's been used by the selectman. It's been used by the wiring inspector. It's been used by me. And it's been used by the police department. Okay.
We could use that to go to our next finance committee meeting.
There you go.
You can. If you really want to risk it, you could.
You can. It's a town,
that
vehicle.
That particular vehicle is getting pretty long in the tooth. Yeah. That's pretty rough.
Is that the old one that's like 20 years old now?
Yeah. It's the Explorer.
Mid-90s
I don't want
Explorer?
To take it.
Yeah.
It's the same age as your Cadillac.
So that amended item, again, is $5,795.
So moved.
Second.
That was a good catch.
All those in favor of $5,795 for building inspector department expense?
Aye.
Aye.
It's unanimous. Okay, so Board of Health. That is $5,115,400.
Dick spoke earlier about knowing the town, and we get so much more value having somebody who knows where to look or knows the town and the neighborhoods. Otherwise, you just got someone you plug in when you... So it's nice to have someone who can go out and minimize.
So, Dick, maybe you could just walk us through the changes to this one.
Which one are you on?
Board of Health salary. So we've got two line items here.
We're in the same situation as the building inspector. That's what it boils down to.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. What are the hours in here? You have 40 hours for the building inspector. What have you got in this one here?
He increased from 12 to 16 hours a week.
16 hours.
And did it increase? That was just as... Then there's a step increase on top of it, or a...
Is it a COLA?
It's a cost of living adjustment. It's a step 10 plus, yes. So the rate went from 3186 to 3240.
And that's
52 cents an hour. Yeah.
What was the increase? How was that calculated?
The cost of living adjustment or the hours?
Cost of living adjustment.
That's the standard 1.7% that we've been using.
How about the hours?
The hours increased to 16. I believe the conversation, if I recall, okay, and I didn't put anything in the notes. The conversation, if I recall it, correct me if I'm wrong, is that we figured that there's going to be some additional collaborative work that the health agent would be doing in with the, not the assistant, but the,
Would you call Valerie an assistant? Or just a per diem kind of person, a backup?
She is a backup person for vacation, sick time, etc. Right.
Okay.
Yes.
So there's a little bit of time that'll be spent collaborating and communicating with that person. But more to the point, the 16 hours a week more accurately reflects the amount of time spread out over the course of the year that the health agent
There's another scenario that goes with that. In the event that we have a problem situation where somebody has a problem, like we need another person to be support, you have to go together on perk tests, for example. I know it's going to fail.
Yep.
The person that has the property knows it's going to fail, but they will try to say that I'm being not quite fair enough with them. So you have to bring another party in to back up for support. We used to have that same situation for when we had a problem. We previous had problems with housing problems with some people, and I could call in the state and have Charlie Kanicki show up and support us, okay? Same situation with Charlie with our infamous pig farm. And Charlie would show up for every single time. He no longer is employed by the state. The position has been dissolved. And so we have no support. So
he's basically for support.
So this is just a...
Did you have that in there before?
No. This is just as this only happened this past year. Okay. We no longer have access to any state support.
So did Charlie retire?
Charlie retired. He's now the health agent in Southampton, I think, in Hatfield.
Okay.
So.
And the selectmen don't back you up anymore like I used to?
No.
Okay.
Can't get anybody to stick their head in the septic tank. To see if it's got a crack or anything. No.
Now, who else? So I'm not as familiar with the structure of the Board of Health within the town of Deerfield. So obviously you're serving your role, and then what is the actual role and interaction between the select board and yourself as it relates to the Board of Health?
They are the
They are
the Board of Health.
Voted in as the bosses.
Yeah.
But he does all the work.
Sure. But so then is it the case in other towns that the other Board of Health members would be the backup that you'd be seeking?
None of them are certified for
any of it.
Most things.
Yeah.
Okay. None of them are certified for septic system inspections. None of them are certified for housing inspection, things like that. So can they go there and put their blessing on something like the installation of a septic system? Not really. Because if there's a problem, it could come back and bite us for having a non-certified person for passing something that shouldn't have been passed.
Are there other Board of Health agents in other towns around here that we could leverage that person, you know, leverage off of in the instances that we did, or that's what this?
That's Valerie.
Okay.
She's the health agent for the foothills. So, very, very, very well versed.
I mean, I guess I'll just, you know, for me, again, it's hard to see both the increase to the hours and the addition of an additional person. And again, this is really just at the backdrop of other areas in town where we're seeing requests for expanded hours and service. And it's
well, if you look at
that there's more going on. Yeah.
If you look at Valerie's hours,
it
only covers vacation time and sick time.
Okay.
Basically.
What happened this past year?
What happened this past year?
Yeah, how do we get through the last few years?
See, the money was taken out of my budget for out of my health agent salary to pay her.
Okay.
Yeah.
What do people think?
Make a motion, we approve it.
Second.
Okay, any further comments? All those in favor?
Aye.
I'll oppose.
You're going to oppose everything?
No, just things that...
I understand exactly what you're doing, and I, you know, generally agree.
Okay.
Yeah.
It's one of those things where here we are late in the budget year and no time to really...
Well, no, there's still time, and you know, that's where I think that... allocating more resources to the inspections department, I support. The question is, how many more resources? Mm-hmm. And that's where, to me... Yeah,
I don't think you've seen the end of what it's going to cost for the Board of Health work here.
And maybe not. I'm not terribly well-versed on the Board of Health work, and so that's why I certainly do support.
If you stayed here and ran for selectmen, you'd learn.
This is covered by fees, right?
That's right.
Dick, this is covered by...
Everything is.
Yeah, all this stuff is.
Every single page
is
covered 100% by fees. And plus... money goes to free cash.
Yep.
And Mr. Kalaszewski, I very much understand that and really appreciate the job you're doing.
I understand.
You, like, for me, it's just there's things that in government and in budgets only go one way. They never go the other way. And those are the things that I get concerned about, not particular to you or the job you're doing.
Mm-hmm.
So, all right, what's next? Board of Health expense should be the next page mm-hmm. in the budget for those who have it. Doug, we have a number of 23,330.
Okay. That's cool. I don't have that.
23,330
is a number I have.
I have 33,330.
Okay. What are we supposed to have?
Here's if we're numbers. Looking at the Board of Health expense, 512-5400.
Right.
Under gas, I've got 500.
Yep.
Under infectious control, 1200.
Mine's blank.
Oh, I got 10,000.
Nope, that's at 1,200.
Oh.
The reason is the separate additional monies item. That Carolyn Ness requested for mosquito control somewhere. Is being appropriated as a separate line item budget. That was the decision by the Board of Selectmen.
Okay. He said 12,000
Carolyn was
at first, but
outvoted on that.
1,200.
So it's at 1,200, which is where it was last year.
Yeah. Okay, so that's...
animal inspections of 1,750.
Yep.
We included 300 for postage. The fees for the nurse went to 19,780.
Yep.
And we have dues of $1,000.
Okay, so there's the 1,000. Okay.
And so that's a total of 24,530.
And I just, you know, postage was new this year. What was kind of the genesis of adding it?
Postage was paid out of the selectman's account previously. And trying to clean everything back up to where it was a few years ago.
Mm-hmm.
The budgets 10 years ago reflected personnel, postage, and all the expenses in the building inspector's budget. A previous town administrator decided to erase all that and take control through the selectman's office. And
that was called internal empire building.
Heard of it. And so I guess, Doug, was there a $300 reduction somewhere in another postage line item to offset this transition?
I do not believe there was.
There may not be because the a lot of that postage is sending out certified letters to abutters and people who are violators. And it's multiple certified letters at times to send them out. So that's another expense that won't go away.
Oh, no, I understand having the 300 in
no,
this.
No, I mean, it's something that probably couldn't have came out of another budget. I think we were underfunded with the postage before. I don't remember. I know Mary probably knows more about that.
This is the familiar refrain this year of a new line item, an old budget that didn't change, and it was overspent the year before.
You started keeping track of that at the town clerk's office, I believe. Yeah.
For what it's worth, when it comes time to take a look at it, the selectman and administrator expense postage budget is going from $600 to $400.
Okay.
No, you took $200 out of it.
So I had previously taken just $100 out, but I just took another
$100.
Make a motion, we approve this.
Second.
Okay, and Doug, can you read us the final number you have? Would that be
24,530?
Okay, so this would be a budget of $24,530 for Board of Health expense. Did I hear a motion for that? Or
yes.
So moved and seconded? Okay, all those in favor?
Aye.
Thank you, guys.
you got, Richard?
We're done. We can all go home.
Well, thank you.
Thank you.
Well, you can.
Thank you very much.
Those are too bad. I understand.
Thanks, Dick.
I just want, I want you to stay, so.
That other thing, let's talk about that tomorrow. Because, yeah, appreciate it.
Are we going to go through these?
I think we're going to try.
Hey, Dick.
See what we got here.
Thank you.
Okay. Let's see. Is that what you're looking at next, is the debt service and the benefits budgets?
I don't know yet.
Okay. Okay, so.
Aren't you putting the same order that you stapled them?
Mm-hmm.
Doug, let's start with the way you stapled them together. It'll be a little easier.
You should, oh, and as a matter of fact, yeah, I don't know why that worked the way it did. Is interest on maturing debt the first sheet that you've got?
No.
Maturing debt, good. Hopefully they're in order.
Okay.
So the maturing debt budget assumes payoff of the energy loan using free cash at special town meeting.
And has that special town meeting date been set?
April 25th. Concurrent with annual town meeting.
Oh, sorry. Gotcha. Yep. Right. Just before. Yep.
If that is paid off,
what are we paying off?
$275,700, I think, is the amount.
Now, wasn't there a principal payment still to be made before that?
I don't believe so.
The FY16 payment had already been made?
No, it hasn't.
I don't think so.
It's in June, $18,000.
We can either pay the $18,500 or we can pay off the loan, $27,500.
No, but I'm saying I think there's $18,000 from last year's budget still to be applied.
In this year's budget.
In this year's, well, fair enough, yes. Yeah. That's been appropriated. That was appropriated last year, sure.
So yeah. Then our pay down amount would be?
$275,700.
No, I think then the pay down would be 258, whatever, because that would be the remaining principal balance.
That could very well be.
Yeah.
Bottom line is that we're not planning to pay anything on this in FY17.
Sure.
If we pay the loan off completely using free cash.
Okay.
If we choose not to, then we're going to need to put in something. It's going to wind up being like a 10-year bond, 27.5 plus interest.
Have the selectmen seen this?
No, they have not reviewed this. This is our just the best guess that Barb and I have.
Okay.
And my thinking here is, to the extent that we get closer and feel strongly we don't want, that the town should not pay off, we can come and revote this one if that would have to result in a, you know, appropriation. So I don't want to hold up this budget for that related but different decision.
So move.
Okay. I have a second.
Second. So that's $340,000, right?
Correct. You'll also notice that there's nothing in maturing debt for the DES roof.
Because the long-term debt would be 18.
It shouldn't be.
Right?
It won't be until 18.
Correct.
The bonding won't go up until next year. So
there's no principal to be paid.
Yeah.
Right.
Correct.
Okay, so all those in favor of maturing debt budget of $340,000?
Aye.
Next should be...
Let me just ask a quick question. On the garage,
correct.
There are two numbers that we look at there. And has that been taken into consideration? There's a $4,000 or $5,000 or $9,000 amount that we can't use, debt excluded. This is really a debt exclusion on this thing, right?
Well,
no, this is not the debt. Okay, never forget. Forget
this
it.
Is just the payment amount.
Forget it. No, it's fine.
Okay, Doug, we have interest on maturing debt next.
That bottom line number should be $231,387. Oh boy. Shoot, did I make the change or did I not make the change? Do you have under DES roof short-term borrowing? Do you have 65,000 or 45,000?
45,000.
Rats. That number should be
65,000.
Can you explain that?
I can. We are anticipating 15,000 due on the short-term note, the one-year note for interest. Barb felt more comfortable putting that number at $20,000 that we will wind up paying to borrow the amount of monies that we need to borrow to put the roof on the building over the course of the next year. When we go to bond out in probably January, maybe February, there's going to be about $45,000 worth of fees associated with doing that bonding.
Therefore, $45,000 in fees plus $20,000 in interest on the short-term note, and we're at $65,000.
Should the $20,000 be in interest on temporary loans?
I asked her about that. She suggested perhaps that would make sense, but then what I suggested was that we leave it here in order to isolate the cost of the DES roof project from other short-term borrowings that might happen throughout the course of any given budget year. So if Barb has to do a short-term borrowing just to solve a cash flow problem, that's on separate. The town side.
So we really should do a short-term borrowing of $20,000 and then fees and...
Are you asking if we should split out the two line items?
Actually,
Skip?
Yeah.
If you care to, that's fine.
And I don't know what you want to call it, but just so that everybody's clear...
It'll the bottom line will still be the same, but you're absolutely
right.
No,
it's
right.
Going to go up
that's
by $20,000 from what we've got.
Well, no, he means if you combine them or not. Yeah.
So,
yeah.
Right.
So the bottom line is going to be 251,387.
251,387. Correct.
Any questions on that?
Yeah. How'd you break that out?
Okay, so I just added another line here. So we have the DES roof, short-term borrowing, interest, if you will.
$20,000. And then closing costs?
And then DES roof, bonding fees and closing costs. Yeah. That's essentially what it adds up to.
Is the 45.
Yeah. Bond fees and closing costs. Sure.
Make a motion we approve this at 251,387.
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed? Okay.
Interest on temporary loans is $5,000.
Didn't we already vote this?
I'm sorry?
I thought we already voted it, but Murdoch.
Did you? Great. Fantastic.
Well, we can do it again, just in case. Do I have a second?
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
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 All right.
Just redid the
temporary.
Okay. You should have a Franklin County regional retirement next up.
Yep.
Okay. The significant changes to this is the offsets, which both Brenda, Barb, Zach, and myself all agree with. And these offsets are directly reflected in the budgets for South County EMS, South County Senior Center, and the wastewater treatment budget. We are all very happy about that. It makes a great deal of sense. We have a solid formula moving forward. And so the bottom line appropriation of $409,340 is something we're all standing behind.
What's the interest rate that we're paying on the Franklin County retirement?
You mean the interest
rate?
There is no interest rate.
There's no interest.
Or what's the
assessment? Roughly about 18.91%.
Okay.
And the way it's calculated is it's 18.91% of the average for the previous 5 years the town, which means that if we broke it out into departments realistically, South County EMS would be paying almost a pittance because 2 years ago they didn't have any employees.
Mm-hmm. No.
So what Barb is actually doing, though, for South County is actually billing them for what their previous year's costs would have been. Mm-hmm. And that's how she came up with the number for that department. I think she translated that over for the other two as well.
Okay, so long as everybody on those sides is happy,
everybody's
what I'm looking at, and I wanted to ask, this would at approximately 20%, around figures, this would, $59,000 would represent, or $60,000, would represent a gross salary of about $300,000.
Correct, and remember that it's calculated only on principal salaries, not on overtime.
And if we're paying people an average of $50,000, that's six people. We have eight in the budget.
Again, correct, so because this is based on last year's numbers.
Okay.
Where we had, I think,
all right, so long as there's an explanation.
That number will go up next year.
And I think things like this offsetting is going to be difficult to be, I don't know if on the screws or fair is the right word, when you have fluctuations in employment in a given department, mm-hmm. but the hope is once it smooths out at whatever that plateau is, then it catches up and is pretty consistent.
Exactly.
So,
make a motion we approve this budget at $409,340.
I second that.
All right. All those in favor?
Aye.
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 It's unanimous.
Where are the Ides of March? Workers' comp. I don't know if that has changed. 52.5.
Yep, net.
The $80,000 is a number that Barbara is comfortable with, and I'm trusting that completely. The offset directly attributable to South County EMS is 23.2. To wastewater treatment, 4,300, and those numbers were given to us by our insurer. And the offset for South County Senior Center was not included because it was like $14 or something like that. It was ridiculously small. So,
yeah, but don't you have three employees over there now?
It's only
three part-time.
There's two part-time, one full-time, but overall, for all of the town's administrative employees, including the library, town hall, and the senior center, the total cost for workman's comp per year is only about $500.
Okay, wow. That's because it's administrative. That's why.
Correct.
Yeah.
Right. The workers' comp is higher for police. Well, not police, but for EMS and for fire, mm-hmm. and therefore that's why South County EMS is covering a good.
Make a motion. We approve 52.5.
I don't want to pick up on. You did when you spoke. I clearly heard you say 22,200, but you meant 23,200.
23,200. Yeah, okay. I apologize. Yes.
Sorry.
And I've
23,200. Where
the offset for this scams?
Offset for our scams.
Doug, I have a quick question.
Sure.
Just looking at this over the past 2 years now, if I understand what we did correctly, we brought in somebody new to manage this in FY16.
Correct.
And we saw a reduction, and now we see a fairly sizable increase. Is this due to changes in the constitution of the town employee structure, or is this we got a good bid the first year and now the rate's going up because you got to change every year like your cable company? Like, what do we?
Part of it is changes to the amount that we're paying for workers' comp, but the increase of the top line, the actual insurance that we're being assessed. And again, that $80,000 is best guess estimate, yep, because even Mick and Maya can't give us solid numbers. That increase is principally, that is principally due to the increased number of staff at the EMS. And therefore, their offset, it went from, I think, from 18 to 23 as a result.
Okay, that explains some of the increase.
Sure.
There's a lot more than that explains less than half the increase.
Our bottom line, 2016 bottom line should have been 46.8.
Yeah, but I mean, the top line insurance went from 66 to 80.
Yep.
Right.
Yep.
So 5,000 of that is attributable to the increase in the skims offset. That,
yep, and about
there.
3,000 to wastewater. And the rest is basically attributable to increases in costs.
Did we have increased wastewater treatment plant hours or employees?
Nope. It's just the amount that we're billing out to wastewater. That's how it got broken out by our insurance company, so that's what we're billing to them.
Okay.
They probably have a higher rate because they're working with machinery.
Yep.
Well, yeah, but they would have last year too, right?
They would have, but even one accident at one wastewater treatment plant can throw the figure.
That's fair.
Can throw the calculation off.
Right.
So.
Okay.
So that's where we're at, unfortunately.
I second your motion, John.
Thank you.
All right. Thank you guys for making a motion, seconding. All those in favor of a budget of $52,500?
Aye.
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 I think you already voted on unemployment insurance, 12040. I don't think that's changed, or has it?
That hasn't here, anyways.
Good. Great.
Are we, how much did we?
We don't have any offset?
No. Actually, she doesn't want to offset anything because if unemployment gets claimed by someone who leaves a department or whatever, or gets terminated from a department or whatever, then she will directly bill the department if we can. So if South County EMS lays somebody off and they claim unemployment and they get it, then South County will be paying for that directly.
What did we vote last year?
Last year...
Did we actually vote 46?
Yes, you did.
Uh-huh. Okay.
Because we were anticipating several teaching positions.
Yeah.
Yeah, we did approve this on 223.
Yep, very good.
Grant.
Group insurance, I don't know what you had before, but I think this number is different.
Grant funded.
So we didn't change that unemployment.
I'm sorry, what is?
Those were,
no.
These were grant funded positions, and that's what it cost us.
Okay.
And we had to board it.
I'm sorry, Doug, you were moving on to group insurance.
Group insurance, I think.
Did it change? Because that we voted as well.
Did it change?
No, I'm asking you if it changed, because otherwise we've already voted it.
It may have, because I think we refined the offsets.
Okay.
This is one of those things where the bottom line number is fixed, and we add to it the offsets to get our top line number. This is a calculation that Barb has stood by, and once I understood exactly why, it makes perfect sense.
Okay.
She knows that our bill will be $825.32. She knows that right now she's going to be billing out to South County EMS and to the wastewater treatment those two figures that are listed there, of 35.4 and 25.47 respectively.
Mm-hmm.
And therefore, her top line number
is, what
is 876,
is.
What it is.
Yep.
So she's going to get a bill for 876,479.
Correct.
She's going to bill out the 35.20.
Yep.
Okay.
So the total appropriation will be 825.32.
Okay.
The 825.32 essentially represents her best estimates for health care costs for the other town employees. And and those will probably not change drastically. Mm-hmm. What could change, and this is where the offset doesn't quite match with the South County EMS budget, Zach is actually appropriating a higher amount for his insurance because he's anticipating additional people using insurance. That being said, Barb is only offsetting the 35.4 here.
Right.
If Zach has two more people that decide they want to take insurance, South County EMS is going to pay Barb more. And so the top number, that overall appropriate, the overall payment will increase, but her bottom appropriation shouldn't change. I don't know if I explained that clearly. I apologize if I didn't.
Fairly,
yes, you
no,
did.
It's,
you did
it's not.
Fine.
Okay. So on this one, are you saying that the line item in South County EMS is different than 35,400?
Correct.
And do we think that's a good thing to have? Not.
Yes.
We do.
Yes. Barb does not want to put in more of an offset because she doesn't have the expenses that she can directly bill out. Right now, that 35.4 represents the cost of insurance for the people in South County EMS that are actually taking insurance right now today.
Mm-hmm.
That
based
could,
on a year.
What's that?
Based on a year's figure.
Based on, right. Yeah, exactly. If people change their plans, increase their plans, add a spouse or a child, then that number will go up and she'll be able to bill out to South County EMS for that amount.
So the South.
And that's why Zach is saying, I'm anticipating an extra 20 grand in insurance that Barb is not necessarily putting in her
budget.
We're
only voting 820, though.
Yeah, right. 825.32. That number won't change.
No.
That appropriation request is solid.
So Zach and Barb can argue about the 35,000 number.
No, she's just going to bill them.
Senior center.
Not going to argue.
That's,
she's going to bill them.
Get it.
And I don't know which number's right. I don't. It strikes me a little funny to have different.
That's the number that. Where we expect to pay out, and if we don't, and if we need to pay out more,
she'll assess them.
This number will increase.
No, I get that. I it'll come out in the wash, but that's where for me, I feel a little less comfortable at having another budget that has a different number than this, even though I do understand why it could ultimately be different.
Mm-hmm.
But that doesn't change my feelings.
This is
about
one of those
one.
Things that we're at some point in time we need to talk about how we're. How we're doing this to make it look better, I guess.
Well, bookkeeping-wise, it's much easier to add to this, to the payment from the South County, than it is to deduct it.
No, I get that, and that's why I'm not saying if it should be higher or lower. I just don't like that they're different.
Let me explain it maybe in a different way. Last year, if you look at the numbers for last year, we had an offset of $69,491 for South County EMS. That was based on Zach's number. Zach set aside in his budget $69,491 that he estimated he would spend on medical care or medical insurance for his staff. He didn't spend anywhere near that much, and therefore Barb could not bill him out that much,
right.
And therefore Barb's appropriation for 2016 is short, and we're going to need to do a reconciliation article on the special town meeting to make up for that.
I gotcha. It's just,
and she's trying to avoid that happening.
I completely agree. It's just when both sides are being conservative, you have more cushions being built into budgets as a whole. I'm not saying that either one is wrong. It's just that's what things like free cash and reserves and reserve funds are for, rather than have each little person along the chain be conservative. But that doesn't affect my feelings about this particular budget, just about those numbers being different between two budgets.
So do you want a motion?
Sure.
I'll move.
which one are we? What's the motion?
Group insurance,
825.32.
825.32. $820,532.
All those in favor of group insurance at $820,532.
Aye.
Aye.
What should we have for that number?
Because the numbers up above are a little fuzzy.
What's that?
On Medicare?
Yeah, so Medicare insurance, there's no offset for skims because
yeah,
they have their own.
Yeah, I was actually just looking into
there
that.
There is. It's up in here. Did this one different? Look at this number.
Yeah.
Why is there no offset?
I don't know if that's the case, though.
It's the latest story now on Medicare.
I think they have it in their own budget this year for the first time.
Employees? Well, they may, but...
So I don't think they're supposed to be an offset here.
I'm not well-versed in that. I apologize.
Well, you don't have to apologize. I'm asking that because as an employer, I always had to take it out.
It's the same as the...
I always had to match it.
Didn't, you know, wherever it is.
So the question is,
if this wasn't...
At one time, they never required Medicare to be paid by town employees because they were going to get Franklin County retirement or state retirement, but we never had to pay that. At some point, I think they changed the law, and they now require everybody to start paying into Medicare so that they up their Medicare income in the United States.
Yep.
And then that way, everybody, when they get 65, they're eligible for Medicare. I think that's the case. So the question is, we have to take Medicare for anybody who earns money in the town of Deerfield, and we have to have an appropriate figure in there. I'm not sure if this is appropriate.
Why is there no offset?
That's a really good question, and I don't have an answer to that. I'm just looking at that. I do have a number for the Medicare tax that Zach has in his budget, but I am reluctant to just say, oh, just use that.
Let's hold on this one until
we
sort that out.
Yeah,
please do.
Yep. Okay.
And Medical Security Act, you've
already... We already did that.
Very good.
Doug, do you have a revised treasurer collector expense? Barbara thought that you might have sorted that out with her and had a updated budget for that.
I do have, well, I've got a number, and that number is 33941. Sorry, the budget number is 145-5410.
Mary, what's the Medical Security Act?
Expense. 145. 145410.
State charges.
145. That's already molded.
Mm-hmm. And.
What?
Mary, all right, this is budget number 145-5410. Does everybody see that? Treasurer collector expense.
What was the number again?
145-5410.
Thank you.
So this is when Barbara came in. She had wanted to gather some more details. Mm-hmm. She had relayed to me. She went through it with Doug, so we'll see. Yeah. What we got and if we mm-hmm. know enough or we need to know more.
I have a number of 33941 for bottom line.
339-4-1.
God.
And the breakout above?
The general expense
yep.
is at 24641. Right.
What's the number you're working on?
145-5410.
Bill, do you need a copy?
I think so. Did you find one, Jeff?
Not yet.
You have two of them.
What's the tax taking?
Tax taking $3,500. And I think the big change is under GASB 45, $5,800. Actuarial services. This is our once every 3 years.
We got to pay for.
We've got to pay for the audit on that. Yeah. What's your total?
What was the tax taking again? Oh, you got it.
5,800.
Oh, that. Well, that's the.
Yes, GAF 45.
But the tax taking.
Tax taking was 3,500.
35.
So we're on
5 or 11, 19, 10. The top line was 24.
Changes if you want to.
Okay. Keep the 5, 13, 1. Adds up right.
Oh, how about that?
Can I?
What was that top line?
Is your copy loose? Can I give it to them?
641.
Yeah, 641.
I don't want to mess up.
But it doesn't have the numbers.
That's fine.
Bouncy Oliver Smith.
That one?
Do you want a motion on this one?
Just give me one second. I just want to give this to these guys so they can see it.
We had on hold.
I can print out clean copies if you.
We are printing numbers.
We don't need them.
33941.
Take the paper.
33.
You can print them later.
All right, here, if you guys want to take a look at this.
Yeah, I got it. Yeah, I did find it.
Yeah, I got it.
Thank you.
Sorry.
Double sided is not.
Yeah, there is double sided.
Okay, so basically, this is a slightly decreased budget, but then the once every 3 years GASB charge is the cause for the ultimate increase.
Mm-hmm. Do you want a motion?
Any questions before we? Okay, then yeah.
Make a motion on Treasurer Tax Collector Section Number 145-5410, a total value of $33,941.
Second.
That was a very official motion. Thank you.
33941.
You're welcome.
All those in favor?
You trained me well.
Aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Any opposed? Okay.
I did that for Mary's benefit because she's so accurate.
Are we doing benefits next?
I'm sorry?
Are we doing this one next?
We had already done that one.
We've already done that.
The other one, Doug, that I think was ready to go, I'm not sure if you had it ready to print, was the police expense. I know there's an email back from John. We can also do it later if that's not the case. He'd revised.
Yeah, he did revise that, so the bottom number is essentially 77,800. An $800 increase over last year.
What number?
Police expense.
210-5420.
210-5420, police department expense. So the changes to this one from what we looked at, which I believe we just passed over, we did not vote when he had come in to present it to us. Mm-hmm. Was a $1,000 reduction in the gasoline line item. And, you know, given that we've seen reductions in gasoline line items in other budgets,
yep.
I thought that made sense. And then there was a $250 increase to the clothing special, the second line item, to take that to $4,000 even. Correct. So those are the two changes from the budget that was presented.
So what's the bottom line number?
77,800.
77,800.
Correct.
So moved.
Could I actually have somebody else move it just to?
Yep.
So moved.
All right, thanks. And a second?
Second it.
So you have to second it?
I thought you weren't supposed to.
The only thing I cannot vote on is okay. My son's salary.
Oh.
I can
mistake.
Vote on everything else.
My mistake, then.
Whatever.
And I don't care. Give anybody credit you want. I
okay.
Just,
yeah.
I'm easy.
Okay. All right, so it's been moved and seconded. All those in favor of the police department expense budget line item of 77,800?
Aye.
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 Okay.
What else are we doing tonight? Let's move it along.
Doug, do you have any others that you want us to vote?
I don't think at this point I do. I'm really hoping to get a complete budget before the Board of Selectmen for the end of the week. I will also say that I hope to have a complete budget packet, a new budget packet for all of you, printed and available to you after 3 o'clock on Friday afternoon. I hope it to include full narratives for certain sections. I will see if we can get Pat Kroll to actually put tabs in between each of the, you know, sections, the 100, the 200, the 300, so you can find things a little bit easier. And it will include, with luck, a final approved budget from the South County EMS, which, if all goes well, I think it'll be a budget that folks will be very happy to see. Let's see if that's true.
Now, they're holding a public meeting the end of March?
The expectation is that the South County EMS will hold a public meeting on March 30th.
Yep.
It's scheduled to be at 7 o'clock. It's scheduled to be at the Whately Public Offices. That being said, there was also discussion earlier today about holding a second public meeting in Deerfield. I'm not sure if that's solid or not. We will certainly let you know as soon as we know. That public meeting is designed to be an informational session about South County EMS to talk about the history of the service, where it's going, the budget for same, and other.
And on.
Could we get another one of these while we're.
Sure.
An updated one.
Sure.
On that front, still targeting to get South County to come in to talk with us next week. I think, unless anyone has objections, we'll just stick with our Tuesday meeting for next week. We'll, I guess 6:30. I think that's been working to start.
6:30?
You know, today we moved it extra to accommodate Marty and Patty's schedule, which I think was a good thing to have done. So way to confirm, I think it's going to be Zach and possibly Mark. Matt is unfortunately traveling, and I know he's been helpful with some of the number side of things, but he's not going to be able to make it in. So I'll send an email around to confirm that if we got it, but I know that that's still to be talked about. The only other budgets that I had that we hadn't voted was the senior center expense, which I'm not sure why, but I want to wait just to sort it out before we bring it up. And then two budgets that maybe other people have some familiarity with, Tri-Town Beach and Summer Swim Program budgets, which I've not yet been able to figure out who is actually the one administering those budgets and how we would be talking to about them.
What you got to do is talk to Doug.
It's in process. I'm just.
He's got to turn around and talk to Roski from Whiteley, Tri-Town Beach, and he's got to submit the budget to him.
Bill Skrosky.
And the second one, you have to talk to whoever the chairman is of the swim program.
A really great question. I have no idea.
That's why I said I'd leave it up to you.
Thanks.
So
I didn't want you to feel left out.
Thank you.
So Doug is working on that, and just wanted to mention those.
Can we vote these?
I don't know how to swim.
No. No.
Yeah, I want to make sure the kids know how. That's my concern.
Yep. Yeah. So here are the list, and we're not going to vote these right now because it's late, but I want to pass these out, and we can talk about these next week as well. These are the Capital Improvement Committee, what was requested, what was approved. Is that enough? Everyone get one?
Yeah.
There's going to be some additions, and I this is brand new information. Because of the requests that are coming through in relation to certain building repairs that need to happen, I'm actually going to talk to John Pereski about readdressing some of the smaller items on the capital list and also adding several items, but also adding a funding source, which otherwise we hadn't considered. And essentially, we're looking at the carpet replacement in the Tilton Library, the air conditioners at the library, and three other items related to the town offices, and one item related to the South County Senior Center building. These items, if the math works out, we want to pull the expense for those out of the municipal building fund. We think we can fund them all out of the municipal building fund so they don't hit free cash. And that'll put $90,000 back in the pocket, back in our good side.
So where do you want to take it out of?
It's the municipal building fund.
How much
is there? We've been taking money out of.
We've got about $88,000 or $89,000 in it.
The difference is in previous years, it's been used to balance the budget. This year, it actually be used for municipal building.
Crazy.
Let's try something.
Yeah, be novel. The wall here. Yeah. So.
Let me ask you a question, and you know maybe you'll have an answer for us. It's my understanding the library board is looking at some major capital expenditures. And if they're looking at major capital expenditures, does it make sense to spend money to replace carpeting if the carpeting is likely to be torn up and tossed away?
The carpeting, if my understanding of their plans are correct, and I only have the most fringe understanding of it, is that they're looking at the possibility of an addition to the current building. The addition may involve some construction in the space in the area that they currently use. Primarily, I think it would be in the basement area that would be the most affected. The first floor might certainly be affected to some extent, but replacing the carpeting and the air conditioners are changes that wouldn't necessarily be badly implemented now, even considering the construction that might happen. That also would not happen for at least another 3 years.
I was going to say it's way down the road.
FY18, yeah, certainly you can speak more to that project than I. That's going to happen in FY18 or 19.
Is
If the funding is available, if the town appropriates the money, agrees to go out to bond.
If it happens.
If it happens, yeah.
If.
Yeah, exactly.
But I don't, even still, I really would, I don't want to spend $5,000 bucks for carpeting if it turns out that carpeting is going to be replaced.
That's right. That makes sense.
So, but if it's not, then that's, you know, totally.
Do you know any details on the carpeting? Is it ragged, torn, safety issue? Is it just
I do not.
Yeah, I mean, that might, I don't know. I just, you know, if it's a safety issue, that's one.
There are certainly sections of it are pretty beat.
Is it? Yeah.
Yeah.
And the air conditioner, well,
it's
got to be.
If the air conditioners are working and there's no, then.
Well,
do people
think they're not working? Then that's another story.
Can I ask a couple of questions on this?
Yep.
Hilton Library, almost $14,000 for carpet, $15,500 for mini splits. What's wrong with the air conditioning they have now?
My understanding is that essentially it's old.
What's wrong with being older if it's still functional? I'll give you an example.
What's wrong with being old? There's nothing wrong with being old. Absolutely not.
Well,
I had one. I had one oil burner. A guy came down because the oil burner stopped working. Mm-hmm. I says, "So what's the problem?" He says, "Well, it's old. You need a new one." I says, "What do you mean it's old? I need a new one. What's wrong with it?" Well, I don't know. The guy couldn't figure out what was wrong with it. Mm-hmm. Had to hire a guy to come down the next day. He told me the same thing. Well, it's old. It should be replaced. All it was one control on the unit. And guess what? The thing was burning at 87% efficiency, and a new one burns at 87% efficiency. So why replace it if you need one control?
They make more money that way.
My understanding is that the air conditioning actually functions at this point.
I thought we asked that question.
Yes.
Yeah.
And
why do they have a photocopier in there for $2,000 when I think they're not supposed to consider capital improvements unless it's over $15,000 or $20,000?
That photocopier is out in the main room, and
that's got nothing to do with it.
Well,
that's still a library function. That should not even be in this budget. That's what I'm saying.
We
it should be in there. It should be in the operation budget.
Should be in their operation budget.
We had encouraged in the past. We encouraged departments not to hide things, but to bring them forward.
Yeah, but now they're bringing so much forward that they're going to nickel dime us to death.
Well, okay.
All right. We're going to go over this next week.
Okay.
So we're not going to vote it.
And could I ask two more things on this?
Sure.
While you're at it, we have the roof replacement earlier funding, $200,000. But there's interest on that, so that should be about $210,000.
I'm sorry, a roof replacement.
Roof replacement for the elementary school.
The offset on roof replacement that's in
the
here for
$200,000. I believe there's interest on that, so it should be about $210,000.
And then we also
did.
And
we get a letter.
Where are you looking? I'm sorry. Right on the cap. That's the capital report.
Yeah.
Okay.
And then we also had a letter that we got saying that we got a volunteer payment of $225,000 from the four tax exempt institutions in Old Deerfield.
And there would also be the transfer request that we approved a month and a half ago.
Correct.
So
I would just like to.
You can speak to John Pereski about that. That's his spreadsheet.
We need to talk about how we're going to use that $225,000.
My recommendation, first of all, is that it's going to sit in an account until sometime next fiscal year.
That's fine.
FY18, because we won't be making any bond payments
until
into FY18. That being said, I've been doing some thinking on this, and I don't know if we can, but my recommendation will be to pay the bond payment using that money in a decreasing percentage over the course of 3 years.
That's one of the options that we should consider.
Yep.
Just reduce the amount of the bond by that is another option, but let's talk about those. That's what I want to do.
We can certainly talk about that. I've actually run some numbers. It will hurt our available revenues more to bond for less money, and it won't. It'll actually cost the town more in terms of the overall impact of the we'll talk about it in details, but I could work up some spreadsheet examples so you can see what I'm talking about.
Well, I think that's a very tricky situation because obviously it's exempt. The debt has been excluded, so borrowing as much as you possibly can has a certain allure for some reasons, but borrowing less money also puts the town in a sounder long-term fiscal position.
Amen.
Reduce the tax rate.
What's that?
reduces the tax rate.
And, you know, I understand that may lead to other difficult decisions in the near future, be it other excluded debt or other overrides if fiscal conditions persist or are difficult. But, you know, and I think we should have a longer conversation about it because it is a very important step in this roof project process. So the only thing I had was we've set next week's meeting to be 6:30 on Tuesday. And Doug, just to reiterate, all of us are very interested to have that joint meeting, you know, sometime the end of this month or very beginning of April with the select board to go over any outstanding items, such as, you know, particular budgets or particular items that have not been resolved yet in the budget process.
Did we ever go over the Tilton Library expenses again? Since it's been redone.
That's a very good question. Was that the Tilton expense budget resubmitted, Doug? She was going to...
Let me quickly check.
Thanks, Mary.
You're right, Mary.
She was going to redo it.
Review.
I do have a bottom line number. That's less than what you have, probably. I would like a little bit of time to make sure that what I've got is exactly what she's looking for. The bottom line number that I've got is 161 and change. So it represents a 2.5% increase exactly. But again, let me walk through the numbers to make sure that what she planned for is what I actually have on this page. So,
and then, Bill, in terms of the capital, when we go through these capital things, would you like to speak for the committee? Should we see if John Preske can join us? What do people
I think I'd rather John, because I may warp things in a way that he wouldn't agree with.
What's the fun of being on multiple
well put, Bill.
In his own manner. Huh? You want him to warp it in his own manner.
Well,
warp speed. Okay.
Bill doesn't want to get warped.
That's it. All right, I'll.
He's growing into the task, and we didn't agree on a couple of things in the beginning, so I'd rather he presents.
Okay, that's fair. Okay.
I'll bring my notes from that committee. The roof stuff didn't cut. When the roof stuff came through that group, they were over and done before any of these other monies came along.
Right. Has that gone out to bid yet?
It went out on Friday. Or at least the bid was published on Friday.
When is it due back in?
I think it's like 4 or 5 weeks, sometime in mid to late April.
Okay.
I think they want to make decisions before the end of April.
Before town meeting, I hope they'd have the information so that we can reflect it.
Maybe not.
Yeah. I think it's out of our hands at this point.
I don't think that's going to be that material.
Well, if the bids come in, I mean, we need to appropriate the roof money, right?
It's already appropriated. It's already
appropriated and excluded.
Special town meeting in January. You appropriated $2.968 million.
The only thing it would change is if the bids came in lower, we'd have to issue less short-term debt and then bond a lesser amount potentially. But it wouldn't affect the budget.
So it's not going to happen.
We don't have to do nothing on it. We've already done it.
Hold on. I did have Dylan pass out copies of this. It's Stan's annual Hampshire Franklin Municipal Conference, which as I see it this year is going to be held up in
Greenfield,
first time. If you haven't gone, it's worth going to.
I think there's at least a couple of staff from our office that are planning on going.
Yeah.
I'll definitely be there for the day, and I want to go to at least one of the breakout sessions. So yeah.
Could you tell Kevin about that? Because there's one big thing in there. It would help him with the highway department.
Yep, absolutely.
I think that's critical.
Yeah,
for
I'll
him.
Make sure the key staff are
met.
I think the one discussion early on the day about K-12 school funding is critical that everybody attend and get informed, because the ability to provide feedback to the state on how our K-12 schools are funded is going to be an essential opportunity. So there we are.
Can I make one more request?
Sure.
Since you're coming out with a new budget for SCEMS, could I get up-to-date expenditures for all the SCEMS activities through the end of February? So that would be an 8 out of 12 month or 2/3 of their expenditures, so I can find out where they stand in relationship to their budget from last year. Because from what I can see without studying it, I suspect that they're going to be over, instead of 500,000, I said last year, 300,000 to 400,000. I suspect they're still going to be over anywhere from 200,000 to 300,000 minimum. And I'm concerned about them building up a big kitty like their initial proposal was to have a $250,000 slush fund, which I don't believe they should have.
Well, I did talk with Zach a little bit in preparation of trying to get him in for next week, and I can't say I know exactly what he's going to say on all these topics, but I've certainly articulated that these are the types of things we want to discuss and not just have big round numbers, but kind of get into the what the plan is for these numbers. So I agree.
Like, for example, I found out tonight about the insurance. I understand a little more about that, but since they've only used $35,000 so far in insurance, I don't understand why they got $75,000 in their budget or had in their budget for next year. So, you know, that's really padding the budget, and it's one thing to have it 1 year, it's another thing to have it a second year, which we fully funded. If they don't have a track record now, they're never going to have one.
There you
now
go.
It's time to straighten it out.
There you go.
Okay. Anything else from anyone?
Really want to hold them to a budget?
All right. Well, thank you guys very much. I think we got a lot done tonight. So
make a motion we adjourn.
All right. All those in favor?
All right.
All right.
Thank you.
Good job. I sent.